Well, everybody, welcome. We're so glad that you're here. You can be seated. I just want you to understand something, that I believe the Holy Ghost, that Christ Jesus and the Father are so interested and earnest about bringing to pass in our lives. I think I was in Japan or in Africa. I can't remember where, but right now. But the Lord spoke to me and he said, I'm really not interested in all the songs and all the preaching. And it was very shocking to me. I'm like, what, Father, what are you saying to me? And the Spirit of the Lord made it very clear to me. I'm interested in you flowing in the Holy Ghost that brings songs, that brings singing, and that brings preaching. Listen, the Pentecostal movement was by and large, the fires of it, in general, the fires of it at large in the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ was put out less than 200 years after the Lord Jesus Christ first baptized the church in the Holy Ghost and fire. Less than 200 years. It was almost extinct. It would only be found in very small groups of people. The large community of the church that basically had already been taken hostage in many respects by the amalgamation of religion with politics, of the church with politics, had altogether, put out the fire, the Spirit, in the midst of the church. 1906, well, really, it was 1904, September 28, 1904, a great moving of the Holy Ghost took place, and really through one man. God raises up saviors, deliverers in Zion. People don't realize this. They think that Obadiah is just talking about, that Obadiah being a very small book of the Bible, one chapter, 23, 24 verses. They don't realize that that's just not talking about the millennial. That's talking about now. God raises up deliverers. He raises up people who so function and flow in the anointing of the Holy Ghost, who Christ Jesus can be revealed through. I want you to understand, Paul was a deliverer on Zion according to the fulfillment of what Obadiah said. He stepped in. He came to realize that Jesus didn't manifest and reveal himself on the road to Damascus just so that he could have a revelation of the person of Jesus. That was huge. But he had a revelation that God had purposed that Jesus Christ would be revealed in him. When that took place, he no longer conferred with flesh and blood because there was nobody who could discuss the subject. All of a sudden, he was getting ready to hear something that Peter had not yet understood. He was getting ready to hear something that nobody else had comprehended about the message of the Lord Jesus and the purpose of the Lord Jesus. So he goes into Arabia for 3 years, and God revealed to him the glory of the new covenant, Christ in us, the hope of glory. He revealed to him that now we are supposed to move in him and walk in him, that all of a sudden this transformation that has taken place by the divine purpose and grace of God has made a whole new race. Try not to shout too much. Really, I mean, because it's shocking. Because I'm going to preach to you things that you're not hearing. You're not going to hear probably anywhere else. And the beautiful thing of it is, you get to examine it through the Word of God and see whether or not these things are true. I'm just telling you what it is. Because I believe in complete redemption and complete salvation, spirit, soul, and body. I believe that Jesus bought us with the price. And when the Spirit of the Lord came upon us, he made a new creation, reproduce the glory of the only begotten Son in our lives. He didn't kind of set us free, he totally set us free. Hallelujah. He caused us to step into the liberty of the Holy Ghost, and so much so that we become the temple of the living God. Our body and our spirits are for him and are supposed to glorify him. And then when you begin to step over into a realm where you belong 100% through and through to Jesus, and your whole purpose becomes about being an ambassador of Christ and being about a sojourner representing the kingdom of God among men right now, all the dynamics of your life change and your problems go away. Somebody said, oh, you come to Jesus, your problems aren't going to go away. Yeah, they will. So long as you don't exalt yourself anymore, so long as you don't make them relevant. I mean, God causes us to step over into the solution. Hallelujah. The supply of the Spirit that has been given to us in Christ Jesus. Anesha, a shepherd that sows, provides for us that we no longer have any lack or want or need. My goodness, to be led and guided and mentored by God the Holy Ghost himself. What a teacher that he lives in us and walks in us and moves in us. In us he lives and moves and has his dwelling and his being. And in him we live and move and have our dwelling and being in Him. It's a relationship where Jesus says, Father, the glory you gave to me, I've given it to them. Come on now. That they may be one just as we are one. I mean, just tell you, listen to me. He's not talking about you and me being one. That's the afterglow. That's the after effect. He says, Father, as I am in you, and as I am in you, and you are in me, I will be in them, and they will be in me, and we will be made perfect in oneness. We're getting ready to step into a place where we're going to have supper with the Lord Jesus Christ. It's called the marriage supper of the Lamb. He's not in that. He's going to drink the cup anew. Now, if you haven't been with us on the past couple of nights, we've been having communion every night. Saturday, we had it Sunday night, Wednesday night. We'll have it again tonight. And just ministering on the subject of all the beautiful symbolism that is revealed in the communion table about something that we're supposed to be living out right now, both in showing forth His death and His coming. And I'm telling you right now, you don't leave the resurrection out. It's not left out. Some of you are saying, well, the Lord, Paul said that we show forth His death till we come. People sit around, you know, and they feel bad about the death. Listen, rejoice. The death has gone and passed away. Hallelujah. The resurrection has come. Hallelujah. And they forget to read on. It says we show His death until He comes. So it's a declaration of both His death and His coming and the soon expectation of us sitting down at the supper table with the Father and something being revealed that we can't even talk too much about right now. But we can say it kind of with hushed tones. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when we see Him, we shall be like Him, for we shall see Him as He is. The hushed tones of the bride of Christ, a marriage supper, a place of being set over, even the seraphims and the cherubims and the holy angels who from the beginning of creation have cried out, holy, 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 who've never departed out of His presence but had been captivated and been in awe of Him for all these eons of time. Suddenly, God places us in a place, in a position with Him where we're shining in Christ Jesus. See, the beautiful thing of it is Christ Jesus, who is the eternal Word, left all of His glory and His beauty, and He took on the form of a servant to be made like unto us. He laid aside all of His wealth and riches and became poor for our sake so that we could step into His wealth and we could step into His riches. And understand this. When we step into His riches, we step into His wealth. We're recognizing that we're stepping into His person, into His life. This oneness with God is so unspeakable. And I want to lead you up today and talking about the oneness with God and how beautiful it is. Somebody said to me, a preacher said to me not too long ago, he said, what happened? Because obviously your mind got renewed. I said, well, the problem is that you've got a doctrine that's holding you in prison. I said, I never had that doctrine. My doctrine was that when I was born of God, again, born of the Spirit, that He took over every part of my being. He wrote His Word and His ways upon my mind and upon my heart that I might do them. So really, reality of it is I just started thinking different about myself. And you understand, let's understand me. Because in Koine Greek, which I would translate Koine Greek, which is layman's Greek, into layman English, I wouldn't translate it, be renewed in the spirit of your mind. I'd translate it like this, think different about yourself. Seeing as God has done all this stuff for you, seeing as you've been made anew in Christ Jesus, that you're a new creature and old things have passed away, behold, all things are of God. Seeing as God has done all this, that he's made you a living epistle where Christ and the things of Christ Jesus is written upon your heart. Think different about yourself. Seeing as you've been given this wonderful gift, now where you can walk in the riches of His grace, receiving the gift of holiness and receiving the gift of righteousness, this as a gift to now be trained up in all of His holiness and be trained up in all of His righteousness, to receive a gift of holiness in such that He allows us to come in and behold Him in all of His glory in the holies of holies. People, I'm going to tell you right now, you don't have to be stuck in some kind of religious ritual system today of any form or type that would hold you back from entering into a heavenly realm. Amen. Where everything that belongs to the supernatural, the miraculous presence of God can be unveiled to you, received by you. You don't have to be limited. God's opened up the door. The door is Christ Jesus. He says, come on in. He is not saying, draw not nigh. He's saying, come behold me. He said, come stare, come gaze, come gawk at me. Come, just come on in here. To those who are far away and to those who are near, he says, peace. His salamim, the salamim sadaka, the peace offering, is the closest thing that represents the communion. It's the privilege of getting down, being allowed to sit down and be one with him and partake of all that he has. Hallelujah. And be blessed with all that he's providing. I want you to step over into a dimension of a baptism in the Holy Ghost today that causes you to be overwhelmed by his presence. Listen, this is what he said. He said, in that day, in the day that the Holy Ghost comes, in the day that the outpouring comes, in the day that I send you the other paraclete, the other helper, the other comforter, the other mentor, the other stand, the one who will stand alongside of you, the one who would teach you, in that day you will know that the Father is in me and I am in you. Many people have never had that day. They've never had the day of union that the Holy Ghost himself brings. The Spirit of the Lord comes and gives us a new spirit, and he gives us a new heart. And really, when you talk about the heart of man, it is like that heart pump of our body that supplies life to every cell. Without the heart pump, you know, the circulatory system's not going to be able to work, and the blood goes to every part of our being supplying the life. As soon as the heart shuts down, it's done. It's done. You know, one of the things that the Lord also describes in terms of his glory, he uses the liver. And actually, sometimes we translate the word for liver in a really unique way. But we understand, and we talk about his honor and his glory and his majesty. And the liver, without the liver, it's just the other vital organ of your body. What's going to happen? It purifies. It purifies and it pulls out every impurity and sustains the whole of your being so that all of this works just perfectly. But just going back to just the symbolism that God uses in the heart, it actually speaks of the whole of the life. It symbolizes the whole of the life. And that's why sometimes in the Greek language, in the Hebrew language especially, you don't know whether you're talking about heart or life or mind, because there are many times you have to translate them equally because of just the context. And I want you just to understand what God the Holy Ghost has come to do. He's come to fill every part of our being, not some little part of our being. He's come to overwhelm every dimension of our life. He's come to live in us, to be with us, and to live in us in that day. And he said, I'll be with you and in you forever. Come on, man. It would just, I've discovered that the miracles of faith simply happen because you begin to agree with the word and speak out the word. The reality of it is your faith will never go beyond that which you're willing to confess. For with a confession, that confession is made unto salvation, and the heart believes unto righteousness. There's too many people believing with their heart unto unrighteousness. And I want to help you to understand this. God gave us a new heart so that we may be sensitive to that which pleases him and to that which grieves him. Father's looking for a person. He said to Saul, he said, I'm going to go find somebody who has my own heart. I'm going to go find someone who has a heart after me. And the beautiful thing of it is David wasn't born of Jesse and his mama with a heart after the Lord. God came with his Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit overwhelmed him, and God created within him the heart that he was looking for. He created that same kind of heart in Saul. It's Saul just departed from that heart. He said, the Spirit of the Lord shall come upon you, and you shall be changed into another man. And he was given a new heart. See, God was always talking to Israel about a heart that was also circumcised. See, circumcision was a mark of the covenant given to Abraham. And so after the time passed, and now God has brought Israel back into the land of the promise, he says, okay, I want you to have the mark of the covenant. I want you to have that symbol, that outward symbol, that you've come into this place of relationship with me. But then he said, listen to me. What I want you to also do and understand is that I want that circumcision to be on the inside more than I want it to be on the outside. I want you to have a heart that expresses that you've come into a covenant relationship with me. And then the Lord takes it to a whole nother level. When we step into the new covenant, the New Testament, and Paul talks about in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 11, and he says, we've received the new covenant circumcision. It's the circumcision of Christ, the circumcision of the heart, which removed the body of the sins of the flesh. Look at this. Come on now. Look up there. Are you looking? Now, if you haven't memorized the Word of God, oh, you got to open your Bibles. Open them. Open your Bibles. Because what happens is I think people just listen to me sometimes and think I'm making this up as I go. Of course, if you've been around here for a while, you discover that's probably not the case. And if it is, any place that it is, I don't want to be that. And the good thing is I've got one who perfects me. Do you have somebody perfecting you? I got someone who provides for me. Do you have someone providing for you? I have someone who protects me. Do you have someone protecting you? Hallelujah. I mean, this wonderful, glorious salvation. I've decided long ago, I'm not going to exalt myself anymore, my problems, my issues. I'm not going to be focused on myself. I'm not going to allow those things that are my own interest to be that which dominates my life. I'm not going to be stubborn anymore. I'm not going to be stiff-necked. I'm not going to be like an ox that you put the yoke on. And the ox will not respond to your leadership at all. You're trying to plow some rows with him to make, you know, some furrows with him to make something good. And he just keeps right on going because he's strong. The yoke of the ox is something that the ox has to be willing to submit itself to your will. Because there's nobody has enough strength to take that yoke, even though it hurts when you pull on it and turn the head of the ox. They're just too big. They're just too strong. And the Lord said over and again to Israel, your heart. He says, you've hardened your heart and you've stiffened your neck. And the only way that we understand that is simply not being willing to be responsive to the will of the master. We come into a place that you and I should have responded to the Lord in such a way that says, I've been bought with a price and I don't have a will anymore. I submit it to you. Now the Lord will come and examine that. He's God who in the New Testament times tries the hearts. He examines the heart. And he doesn't do it to prove that you're wrong. He does it to come and correct us and to instruct us in the ways of life. Somebody talks about how the Father, you know, he's not going to, you know, impose his will. I don't even really understand what people say when they start talking about things like this and, you know, and they start acting as though God's not the ruler and the commander. I'll tell you right now, every son that he receives, he chastens them. I mean, you know, if that's not imposing the will, I'm saying, Lord, impose your will on me. You know, I don't even understand that kind of thinking where people say, well, you know, God's just going to let us do whatever we want to do. Well, that's true, but I don't want him to let me do whatever I want to do. I want to be taught of God, and he's promised that. He said, he literally said this, I will, in the new covenant, I will give you a new heart. I will write my laws and my statutes upon your heart and upon your mind, and you shall do them. In the new covenant, we have a description in the old covenant of God saying, I shall make you. Oh, everybody wants to translate it. Cause you. Okay, cause. Because I don't know what it is. It seems like we were unwilling to come under the rulership and the mastery of God Almighty. I'm going, make. I'm not interested in just cause. I'm like, Lord, let your sovereign glory rule over me. I submit myself to you. You know what? You're going to submit yourself to somebody. You're going to be overcome by something's going to be your ruler and governor in your life. Some people have made it money. Some people have made it their job. Some people have made it, you know, various different things that come up out of the realms of pride and greed. Why don't you just go ahead, hallelujah, and make God the ruler of your soul? Why don't you make Jesus Christ your ruler? Why don't you make God the Holy Ghost your ruler and just start talking to him like that? And I'm telling you, the response you're going to get when you start believing in a personal relationship. I wonder sometimes how many people truly, really, truly believe in a personal relationship with a very present God. Because many folks act like he's far, far away in a place called heaven and that somehow they're only going to interact with them through some ritual. Look, he's come to live and dwell on the inside of you. Papa gave us a new spirit for one reason. So that everything about our life could begin anew. To begin anew. Because when we were born in sin. And we were shaped in iniquity. Every day we were taught to be like the devil, to act like that which is opposed to God. One day we were born again. We were born from above. Jesus said, I am from above, you are from beneath. I am not of this world. You are of this world. John chapter 8. Then he comes along in John chapter 17 and says, you're not of this world, even as I'm not of this world. We are born from above. Actually, in John chapter 3, you may translate to be born again, lest a man be born again. You translate that as accurately, and maybe there's some argument that it's actually a little bit more perfect. If you translate it, you must be born from above. The reality of it is actually equivalent. I like born from above because I like getting people out of an identity being fashioned and shaped like the world and like man, to now begin to bear the image of Christ Jesus. This is what God's called us to do. You say, oh, God, do this work. He's done the work. You go, oh, Father, thank you for this work you've done. It's a whole different realm of living. I begin to live by the word. I begin to speak the word of God. Those things that God has said, even in the biggest crisis, I'm thanking him for the glory that he's given me. I'm thanking for the riches that I have in Christ Jesus, all the spiritual riches. I don't care what people are saying, what circumstances dictate, what the present world would try to impose upon me. I'm going to exalt the word of God. What happens is faith begins to work in that realm. A miracle goes forth with a proclamation of the word of God by the Spirit. My, if I could just get you to start prophesying over yourself, it'd be the best prophecy anybody ever gave you. It'd be the best. It'd stick. If I could just get you to start prophesying the word of God over your life in another dimension, start saying, I'm in Christ Jesus, he's in me. He gave me an invitation to come and live and dwell in him. What does that mean? I can't move into his house and open up the refrigerator and eat out of the cupboards and sleep in the bed. He's talking to me about having my whole thinking, my whole life, my whole purpose, my whole identity, being in him. He opened up the door to his life and said, come on in, everything I've got's yours. Will you accept it? He cries out and he says, come dwell in me. Come abide in me. He said, if you abide in me and my word abides in you, you can have whatever you want. Now I want you to understand this. You can have whatever you want is something that is so key to what Father has purposed to be produced in our lives as a fruit of relationship. So when it comes down to the place where it seems like you've asked for things and haven't gotten them, understand some things need to be adjusted about the way that you interact in your relationship with him, fundamentally about how you allow yourself to be willing to take up that identity and dwell in him. That's your will. If you say with your heart, listen, I only will to do the will of the Father. And he said that I exist in him, and that I'm supposed to dwell in him. I'm going to dwell in him. And everything about my life, I demand it to be conformed to that and to submit to that. So that in every way, I find myself, my consciousness, my identity, my reflexes are formed to say, I'm dwelling in Christ Jesus, and I'm allowing his word to dwell in me. In that place, if we do it, as he said it, and I believe it's really in proportion to as we do it. As we agree with God, we get to reap the benefits. Yeah. The places that we don't agree with him, it's not that like he's withholding. It's there, we're just not receiving. Amen. So I wrote down a list of a couple of things here this morning I want to just read to you. But are you looking there in that verse of scripture there in Colossians chapter 1? Huh? Oh, I'm sorry. Everybody's looking at me strange. I'm wondering what's going on. I figured that they thought I was misquoting it. I was, right? Because it's 2:11. So look at that quickly with me. I want you to just stare at it for a minute while I find my notes. I'm preaching from my iPhone. I don't know if I've ever done that. Look at that verse. Scripture is amazing, isn't it? Somebody got it open, so am I quoting it right? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Look at that. He said, come on now. He says to us, just kind of read it with me, would you? In whom also we are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands in the putting off of the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. I'm buried with him in baptism, wherein also I'm risen with him through the faith and the operation of God who hath raised me from the dead. There's a lot of people still trying to die. Poor you. I'm glad I'm not you. trying to die. You don't get to have resurrection until you die. Hallelujah. And no place in the Bible says he wants you to die. And it's just it's in that way, in that sense that you're dying, trying to die so you can step into this salvation. Salvation has brought you into a place where now you can spend the most of your life trying to die. I mean, this is a crazy doctrine. There's no place in them. God says something far more difficult than that. He says to deny. Hallelujah. And he says, he doesn't tell you really. I mean, think about this for a minute. He doesn't say deny. He does say this, but he doesn't say specifically this at this juncture. He says, doesn't say deny the devil. He's saying deny yourself. Yeah. Whoa. I mean, wait a minute. We have so exalted ourselves. A culture that we live in has so admonished us to go with whatever we want to do. Wait a minute. Father has brought us into a place now where we don't live for ourselves anymore. 1 Peter chapter 4 begins to stand out to us that we no longer live to the will of humanity or to the will of man or to the will of the flesh, but we live to the will of the Father. Because just as Jesus was manifested in the flesh and he didn't live after his flesh, so we don't either, because now we've been given over to a glorious realm to live after the Holy Spirit, to live after the will of the Father. And so I wanted to grab a hold of you, and I want to bring you into the converter and get you converted completely. I want to bring you into the transformer and get you completely transformed on the other side. When you think about how Paul describes salvation, I want you to have this today. I want you to embrace it. You can't earn it. It's a gift. You can never reach this level. It's given to you. You've got to accept this. And then when you accept it, he then reveals and releases all that he has to us as we grow in this wonderful grace. As newborn babes, we desire the sincere nourishment of the Lord. And we don't have to stay like little children. We can grow into the fullness of the measure of the maturity of a ministry of Jesus, even unto a fully matured man. If we don't faint, if we don't get discouraged, if we don't become waysiders, if we don't allow the doctrines of men and the philosophies of men and the traditions of men to spoil us after man and after the rudiments of the world, the way that men think about things, rather than after Christ Jesus. I mean, God called us to be conformed to him, to live out his life. This is the new covenant. This is what Paul discovered. This was what was unveiled to him, that God had purposed to reveal his son, Christ Jesus, in him. And that he then, in understanding that, was allowed by God to write basically 2/3 of the New Testament to help us come to understand that we no longer live. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And we're having a hard time with that. We're unwilling to embrace, for me to live as Christ. The life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. Hallelujah. We have a hard time expressing this and allowing ourselves to just believe this beautiful thing that God has come set up his residence on the inside of us. That Christ Jesus is here, and he's come to manifest himself to us. That the Holy Ghost is here, and he's come to reveal Christ Jesus through us. That God the Father has taken up residence. That the veil of the temple was rent, and the holies of holies was removed from a tabernacle made with hands into the midst of your heart. Into your heart. Into your heart. Into your heart. Into your heart. Religion want to say, your heart is wicked. My heart's not wicked. Christ Jesus is the master of my heart. It's his throne room. It's his throne room. And out of the throne room, the living word expresses his word through me. Come on, people. It's a transform everything about your life. God's looking to raise up a whole army of people that function and move just like Jesus Christ. Once, and not only with the works which he did, but greater works. I'm telling you, the time is coming in the near future where we'll have to take the few loaves and fishes and multiply them, because the need will be so great. And oh, isn't it going to be exciting to have to be in a position where we must do the works of Jesus Christ? The miracles are demanded upon us. That people might begin to see this glorious provision. But you and I are going to have to understand the provision to start off with. Start living in it by faith. I mean, stop depending upon a job. It's good that you got a job. Praise God for it. But it should not be your source or supply. It shouldn't be the end all. It shouldn't be the meaning of your life. It shouldn't be where your vision is fashioned for what you're going to do with the rest of your future. It's just a stopping off place. It's a mission field. Yes. Hallelujah. Begin to let God be all in all. Begin to let Him be your everything, for that's what He desires. Begin to find yourself in Him. He gave all Himself for us that we might find ourselves completely in Him. I believe it grieves the Father's heart when we make ourselves other than Him. Man, I tell you right now, if you'd been in some of the theological circles that I've been in, and you'd be sitting and talk about the transcendent other God, I mean, it's enough to make you, you know, it's enough to choke a mule. I mean, it's so terrible to have to listen. And some of you have been in seminary settings, and you know what I'm talking about. My goodness. You know, but what's worse than that is where people live out that kind of a doctrine without even saying it. They act like God's a foreigner. He's aloof. Somehow He's not in the midst of me. He's in the midst of me. God made His covenant of blood and sprinkled the people with the blood that He might dwell in the midst of them. He gave them a gift of holiness. Look at it. He gave them a gift of holiness so that He might dwell in their midst. Even though they're hard-hearted and stiff-necked. Look at what Balaam prophesied. Oh, that my end was theirs. For he shall not behold sin, nor shall he regard iniquity. Think about that. My goodness. I mean, those guys were messed up. And God extended a covenant that He might train them up. But they were unwilling. They want to continually regard themselves and fashion themselves after former things and look back into Egypt. They wanted to look back. And they looked and was jealous, the jealous eye upon their neighbors and said, they have a king and they have these gods that they can see and handle. We want something like that too. Our God's invisible. We want something we can see. They turned away, their hearts turned to living God so that He could not train them up in the gift of the covenant that He had given and extended to them. The opportunity, to come on in. The opportunity to be one with Him. They didn't, at that time, did not have the opportunity of oneness. God gave special anointings. You can understand about anointings when you listen to this. God gave special anointings, divine abilities to certain people to be able to interact with Him. He gave a special anointing to Aaron the priest to be able to come and stand in front of His presence and minister in His holy place. A special act of divine grace and ability He gave to just certain people, certain prophets, certain men that He poured out His glory upon. But now in these last days, saith God, I pour out my spirit, upon anybody who wants, anybody who will receive. People, you and I are going to have to be willing to step into another dimension of submission, if you would, to the Word of God and begin to live out in very practical ways those things which God has said about us so that the release of His glory might be the full effulgency of divine power that He's promised. Listen, He's talking about His life and His glory being manifested in our lives on such a scale that He couldn't even find any human language to express it with. So He said, it's going to be like rivers gushing out of you. Come on now. People, listen, praise God for the joy. Praise God for the love. This is the things that establish us in these things. Hallelujah. It establishes this, but it just takes us into every dimension of maturity, into His glory, into His character, into us, into the yieldedness to the Holy Spirit, first and foremost, that develops that and matures that. And secondly, and to the full expression of His divine power so that in His name we do exactly what God has told us to do. I mean, if you look at every time the Lord is talking about His anointing being upon people in the new covenant, the Holy Spirit empowering people, the first thing is He gave them power against unclean spirits to cast them out. Yeah. Reality of it is, people, unless we know how to bind the strong man, unless we're willing to function, flow in the anointing and the authority of the Holy Ghost, and that's how you know how to bind the strong man. It's not a knowledge that you get and you acquire. It's something that you receive and you allow to flow out of you. Hallelujah. With a glorious divine inspiration, it becomes bigger than anything that you know or experience. Hallelujah. It's true. And that ultimately opens up the door for us to be more effective in every area of our life. In every area of our life. But what happens when people begin to be conformed to this world, they begin to take on the identity that Satan in his deceptive and subtle means of preaching to the mass population of the church, we begin to take on things that threaten our identity in Christ Jesus, that somehow lower the threshold of who we are. One time I told the Lord, I said, I had so many people saying, Mark, if you just make this adjustment, make that adjustment, the church could be a whole lot bigger. And I mean, I just wanted to be, you know, respectful to everyone and, you know, just listen to everyone. I listened to that. And the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me and said, what do you want? You want me or people? I said, Lord, I want you. He said, just preach my word. I thought, well, Father, if I just maybe just lower the, if I maybe lower the bar a little bit, you know, if I just lower the bar a little bit and we just make some of these, you know, some fundamental things to make it more like, you know, just a social event on Sundays or when we get together, maybe we could be able to reach more people. The Spirit of the Lord, you know, I was talking like that, something like that. Spirit of the Lord said, you lower the bar and you're preaching another gospel. You change anything about my word and anything about the call. I've called and purposed people not to be conformed to this world, but to be transfigured. Listen, to be transfigured by thinking different about yourself. Because what's happened is I watched how Wesley made a second work of grace because of his encounter of the Holy Ghost through the Moravians. I've watched as modern times people made a second work of grace out of soul salvation and out of your mind now being renewed. That's a second work of grace and no difference. It's no difference. Think about it. Put it in your theological hopper and stir it around a little bit. See what comes out. It's the same thing. We're always waiting for an event that's going to happen in the someday. God's already done it yesterday. Yes. God's already established it today, in this day, right now. Yes. It's about us receiving. I mean, I know people who they're just not willing to believe that Christ Jesus came and the opportunity is there for their salvation. All they've got to do is call upon the name of the Lord. They just think that it's just too simple. It can't be that simple. Well, I believe that there's a lot of God's people who do the same thing with all the rest of what God has brought in the whole package deal with us being born from above and being made a new creation. And it's time that people, somehow you just go ahead now and leave behind all the things that you think you need to do. And understand, have you begun in the Holy Ghost to now be made perfect without Him? Have you begun in the Holy Ghost to now be made perfect by your own ability? Have you begun in the Holy Ghost to now join up with Hagar so you can have yourself an Ishmael, even though your Isaac's already here? I mean, come on. Yeah. At least Isaac wasn't around when Sarah come up with the idea. People got it reversed. Isaac's here. The miracle new supply of the Spirit of God, that which God could only do when is past human ability. And that's the hardest thing for you and I. Because we're so wrapped up in human ability. The strength of the flesh. The arm of flesh. No devil in it. Human in it. Human ability. There's no excuse. The devil, he's been paralyzed from the eyebrows down. The blood of the cross did it. Read about it. Colossians, read about it. He was paralyzed. Spoiled. Paralyzed. The word means paralyzed. Paralyzed from the eyebrows down. Or just above the eyebrows. He can't even move his eyebrows. Hallelujah. Think about it. God has done this wonderful thing. Somebody said, oh, I wish I could be in a place and walk with God where that I could get translated like Elijah or translated like Philip. And I'll tell you right, Jesus translated many times. I can prove that to you if you don't understand that in the scripture. He did many translations. When you pass through the hands of people who got a hold of you, like a Jew would get a hold of you when he's mad, you have to be translated. Okay, he disappeared. Hallelujah. Oh, listen, I'm just trying to understand. God has translated us. Ooh, we've been translated. We've been translated from the kingdom. Huh? We've been translated into the kingdom of the dear Son, delivered out of the power of this world. Translated. We get to be transfigured. People want to talk about caterpillar. Turn into a butterfly. Ain't nothing about that in the Greek word. Somebody said, well, in Attic Greek. I don't care nothing about Attic Greek. I want to understand first occurrence and application and context to Scripture. The first time that word is used in the Bible, they were there in the mount, and they saw Jesus as he was praying. Suddenly, he was transfigured before them. Woo, I guarantee that'll change the way you think. Yeah. Hallelujah. I guarantee you, your thinking will actually work out that event. If I have never felt, I love the manifest presence of the Lord. I have never felt the manifest presence of the Lord complaining and being disappointed and being upset and talking bad about myself and running my salvation down to the ground. Oh, God, what's wrong with me? That's running your salvation right down into the ground. You're listening to me. I always feel the manifest presence of the Lord when I'm praising Him and I'm thanking Him for His goodness. Got my names written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Hallelujah. That He's with me. I'm in Him. Hallelujah. I mean, and one of the places to really have this come and explode in your life is when everything looks like a disaster. When everything looks totally like a disaster, it looks like God, and by all evidence, God's nowhere near you. And you're thinking, oh, Father God, I thank you that you're walking in me, that you're living in me. You see through my eyes. You talk through my mouth. You minister through my hands. You walk through my feet. Hallelujah. Mom goes, so when you start believing God, you'll step into an inheritance, and your steps will be an inheritance, just as it was with Abraham. Everywhere the sole of his foot touched the ground, God gave him it to him as a possession. There was something that would be revealed yet in the future. Not even now, but something in which he would be able and empowered by his agreement with God to be the inheritor of the worlds to come. Worlds, hallelujah. Something that we can't even talk very specifically about. Come on, people, listen to me. God's got far more for you than you've ever begun to even think about. Ann and I were driving down the road the other day talking about what we're going to be doing 10,000 years from now. I said, baby, I opened it up like this because I was just being so overwhelmed by His presence. I said, do you know where we're going? We're driving down the road, you know. She's kind of looking at me. She knows where I'm at, though, because we just live this way. Everything about our life is the Word of God. We process our life around the Word of God. Everything we move in, we've always just moved in a determinate purpose. Sometimes, not by the Holy Ghost, but by our own grandiose ideas, to take a hold of all that Father had for us to do. And even in our grandiose ideas, I mean, Father's there adjusting us and saying, no, you can't do it your way. I got it bigger. Even when you think that, hey, you can do it, so, you know, you can have this, or you can have that, or you can make it happen this way or that way. No. Father, say, no, I want you to stand still. That's how you get God's miracles, standing still. Amen. That's a hard thing to learn. Stand still and behold my salvation. God always brings His provision to us by miraculous supply. Yeah. He's never going to do it just casually. He's going to say, guys, okay, we're up here at the Jordan now, build a bridge. Okay, guys, we're up at the Jordan, it's overflowing the banks, I want you to build a bunch of rafts. Because that's how men would do it. If men wrote the Bible, that's what it would say. He said, stand here, what's going to happen? I'm going to cause the flow of the Jordan to go instead of from the Sea of Galilee to the Dead Sea. I'm going to have it go from the Sea of Galilee straight up to heaven. Amen. And you get, hallelujah. I'm going to form a big pillar for all the world to see so that you can step into your inheritance. This is the way the Lord does everything for us. You said He's your provider. He's going to do it by way of a miracle. Every idea and concept that we come up with where we're going to help God out, it's an Ishmael, believe me. I should have learned it just by reading it, but I learned it by experiencing it too. And so many of you, and if you haven't yet, don't. Just let God do it, okay? He would say He's your provider, He's your perfecter by means of a miracle. He's going to do it by means of, He don't need your help. He just needs your agreement. Hallelujah. Can you hear me? Testing 1, 2, 3. Can you hear me? God takes foolish things and does mighty things through them. When He poured out the glory of heaven, He said, I'm going to give them stammering lips and the voice of another tongue, something that they've never heard before. I'm going to give them the miracle of a new tongue so I can begin to establish within them the ability to speak after my kind of thinking and speaking, to be able to act after my kind of deeds and doings. If you've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost today, you don't want to leave this place without the wonderful gift of the baptism of the Holy Ghost. It's where heaven, God has brought forth the greatest riches and the greatest treasure that He had was the outpouring of the Holy Ghost, and you want to receive that which He has. If you've not received the salvation that can only come by the work of Jesus Christ, by calling on His name, you don't want to leave out of here today living any kind of other life. There are people in this place right now. The Spirit of the Lord has never come upon you and changed you into another being. I believe some people have responded to altar calls, but they never had the event. Come on. God wants you to have the event. Yes. I mean, there was a place and a time, and all you looking back at all the revivals of the past, there was nobody that left the net without people tackling them, staying on top of them, and praying through. Amen. It was called praying through. Amen. It was the mass conversions only took place with Billy Sunday. Up until that point in time, you had to pray through. An event had to happen. A proof had to be given that you were changed before you could ever receive baptism or communion. And that isn't religion. That was just simply people wanting to receive the change of grace take place in the lives of those who have been taken prisoner by Satan, who lived under the yoke of demon power, to not let anything escape out of the way. Yeah. The Lord Jesus gave us that authority. Yeah. He gave us the purpose and the ability to go and destroy the works of the devil. Beginning, hallelujah, in our own house. Because when I'm tell you, when you've been delivered, by Christ Jesus, Satan, like Pharaoh, comes out to try to reclaim you. He's mad. He's an imp. He's rebellious. He don't believe anything God said. He still doesn't believe he's defeated. He doesn't. He doesn't believe that you are born again, and he doesn't believe that you're on your way to heaven, and he doesn't believe that your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and he don't care. And he's going to come at you that way, and people don't know their authority, and they don't understand who God has made them, and so they let Satan impose his nasty, filthy will upon their lives. You have to get yourself some authority that comes by being made a son of God. You have to be a son and a daughter of the Most High. You're going to have to become bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh. You're going to have to find your confidence and certainty in him. I don't cast away your confidence. It has a great payday for you. It has a great recompense of reward. You got to grab a hold of who God has made you to be. I know about the stronghold of disappointment. I know about the stronghold of discouragement. I know that it can actually take you into a prison and lock you in there where it seems like it's impossible for you to ever hope again, much less move in faith. But God has given us weapons. He's given us the weapon of his word, which is, listen, it's like a sword. That's how you don't cut bread with a sword. You take heads. God's giving you a sword, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. I don't know what we were looking for when they're looking for weapons of their warfare. But I'm going to tell you right now, the greatest weapon of your warfare is to agree with God's Word and call it done. And if it's not done, get it done now. Amen. So you can call it done. Hallelujah. Yeah. Praise the name of Jesus. Praying with all prayer in the Holy Ghost, with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. People just think that that's just some kind of prayer you come up with. I lay me down to sleep prayer. No, that's a prayer that comes out of you like gushing forces, hallelujah, of rivers by the Holy Ghost. That's the same. Hey, look, Ephesians 6:18 is exactly the same as Jude 1:21. Build up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Huh? Keep yourself in the love of God. But the praying in the Holy Ghost is defined by Paul. And he made it very, very clear. The one who wrote Ephesians 6:18 is the one who wrote 1 Corinthians chapter 14, hallelujah, 13 through 15. Said, what should we do then? We'll pray in the Spirit and we'll pray with the understanding also. And that's where the Holy Ghost prayer now excels. Hallelujah. Yeah. If there's anything I want to see people doing, every one of God's people, I don't want you to be hindered anymore, especially some of you guys that are just, you know, I praise God for the brains that the Lord gave you, the intellect that God gave you, the spirit of understanding God gave you. But it's time to more fully give that over to the Lord and understand how easy it is to live out your life in tongues and interpretation of tongues. Tongues and interpretation of tongues is in the church, but it's not just for the church. It's for your daily life. Hallelujah. Amen. And the Spirit of the Lord begins to speak through you to tell you exactly what's going to happen today so that you understand how to make every movement with him. Tongues, and the interpretation comes. Tongues comes under the same inspiration. And there's no reason for anybody not to live their life like that in this place. Right. You get saturated with these wonderful things of the Spirit. There's no reason for you not to live in a miracle, not to live in the gifts that God has supplied by the Holy Ghost. These are the manifestation of the Spirit that is given to every man. Every woman too. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. To live in these things. Listen, you're going to have to understand, doubt and unbelief can't hang around where the word is being spoken. It can't. It's the weapon of your warfare, which is mighty. It brings down. It corrects every wrong imagination. It brings, it subdues every thought unlike Christ Jesus that is absent of the knowledge of what he's declared and said and who he is. Then, now, and here, presently in me. Who he was then when he walked the living word, who expressed the written word, walked the earth 2,000 years ago. He's walking in me right now. He Amen. Lives and yes. dwells in my heart. Yes. Hallelujah. By faith. Somebody said, by faith. Oh, but that's just some, you know, that's some mystical, you know, esoteric thing that's not really happening. No, by the faith of the New Testament. The faith of the New Testament is centrally this. Is that you've been born of the Spirit and that you are a new creation and that God's in you and you in him.
Hallelujah.
That's the faith.
Yes.
That's the faith. That's the faith.
Yeah.
There's one kind of faith. It's a Jesus kind of faith.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Mangazekaya. Halebora. There's no two different kinds of faith. There are three different kinds of faith. There's no Hindu faith, Buddhist faith, Jewish faith, Christian faith. That's nonsense. They're stealing a word that doesn't belong to them. Faith is only one faith. It only comes from God by the Holy Ghost to you and me. Come on, people. There's a supply of the Spirit, hallelujah, that will overwhelm you like joy, that overwhelm you like love, that overwhelm you with all the things from above. But if your heart isn't right, you can't draw near unto him. Who can come unto the mountain of the Lord? Those who have clean hands and a purified heart. I got mine right from Jesus, hallelujah.
Amen.
Mine don't even exist outside of his presence. I'm in him, he's in me. I just look at Jesus. I don't look at me. I look at Jesus. I look in the mirror. I see Jesus. For me to live is Christ. People are afraid to do that. You need to accept it as an unspeakable gift. It's your gift for me to live as Christ. Well, I don't want to let him down. You won't let him down. He'll uphold you.
Yes.
You start confessing
amen.
The right confession.
Yes,
you start moving in his word in agreement with him.
Yeah.
And you'll see a radical change taking place very quickly. Hallelujah. You wake up in the morning with his likeness. You go to bed at night. You can't get much done when you're sleeping. But you'll go to bed at night and you will arise with his likeness in the morning. Come on.
Come on.
Yes. We just want you to get so bold.
Uh-huh.
Hallelujah. You know, I was so blessed, you know, how that, you know, recently, not too long ago, Dr. Stewie had a person come to his office who no one could diagnose the problem. So he just prayed over him and baby got healed. Hey, it's really, really great when you don't need to diagnose the problem. You just lay hands on them, say, in Jesus' name, they healed, and they healed. How the Hindu woman didn't know what to do with herself. Wait a minute, you're supposed to be the doctor you highly recommended in the community of San Diego, which is a cutting-edge medical community. What'd you say? You just laid your hands on and prayed in the name of Jesus. I thought only ignorant people did that. Come on. Come on. Dear people, doesn't care what, I don't care what Satan comes up against you with, what adversary comes up against you. The word of God, it can be altered. It can be changed. Oh, the beauty and the splendor that has been brought to us by Christ Jesus. We want everybody to get to hold this. So I want to know how to walk with God. He wants to give you a new spirit. So he wants to give you a new heart so you can be sensitive to what pleases him. And what grieves him.
Thank you, Father.
Before that event, you just run wide open with the things of this world. You run right open with demonic activity.
Yes.
And never think twice about it. Just having fun looking for some more.
Yep.
What you feel to be fun, which is really the death. But God comes to give us a new heart. So now we can come under Holy Ghost conviction. Praise
Hallelujah.
God for Holy Ghost conviction. God gives us a new heart so we can get some godly sorrow in
Amen.
Our lives. Don't go pat anybody on the back and tell them it's going to be all right. Let godly sorrow seek in. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Leave them alone. Amen. Let them touch heaven, get right with God.
Amen.
And then
yes.
get, you know, let that work within their life. Such a resolve to be those people who God has made us to be. We a new race.
Amen.
I said we new race.
Yeah.
We new race.
Yeah.
Born of the Spirit. Jesus for forever. He will forever retain a human body that's been resurrected to the divine. Forever.
Forever.
Nail prints in his hands.
Yes.
Somebody said, well, what age do you think we will be in the resurrection? I said, I don't really even care. I just want to be there. I don't really even care. How do you think we'll be 20? I said, listen, Jesus got the scars in his hands and the stripes upon his back and the nail scars in his feet. I don't know. It's going to be so glorious. Don't even think about it. Don't even think about what it's going to look like. Just set your heart on being there. I mean, Paul says in Romans 15:19, I fully preach the gospel. From Jerusalem to Illyricum, I have fully preached the gospel with mighty signs and wonders and the power of the Holy Ghost. And some years later, he writes and he says, oh, that I may know him, hear the hunger. Oh, that I may know him in the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death. Listen to the cry. Everything that you are, that is what I demand. And God says, everything that I am, I want you to be. I want you to have these works and greater works. Somebody said, are you trying to say that we're going to be like God? Listen, don't misunderstand me. He's filled us with everything he is. We don't exist outside of him. You can't even understand what I'm saying from an intellectual point of view. God will always be God. We'll always bow before him. He'll always be far above all in all. And he will be the one who receives all the praise and the honor and glory. The reality is he's opened up a door so that we may now exist in him. Amen. And if there's anything I want God's people to do is start living the life of Jesus. Yes. Not too long ago, the Lord said he's going to start sending me to churches across the United States of America and to proclaim to them to do this one thing, receive the life of Jesus. Amen. Just receive it. Yes. Receive it and then just walk out, get up, stand up and start walking out the life of Jesus. Come on, man. Instead of dreaming about it. Hey, listen. Hallelujah. Come on. Listen to the heavenly vision. Listen to the boldness of the heavenly vision. And I'm still just talking about your heart and the state of your heart. I'm talking about the Word of God abiding and dwelling in your heart. I'm talking about the Word of Christ being there. The Word, the living Word of God being there. Always present there. The reality of doing these works and greater works than these. The reality of all that Father has supplied to you and me. It goes beyond expression. You just begin to start living it. You accept it. You embrace it. You have this identity of yourself. You cast out devils. You see somebody sick, you lay hands on them and you tell them to be healed in Jesus' name. Amen. You don't pass up somebody with a toeache, a sniffle, a headache, a problem, or anything else. And it's just going to grow and it'll become more apparent. To become more radical. You got to learn to quit running to the medicine cabinet. I want you to listen to the radicalness of the heavenly vision. When God gave Paul the heavenly vision, which he confessed before Felix, he said this. He said, God appeared to me. He gave me a heavenly vision. I've been faithful to it. He gave me the power to turn people from darkness to light, from Satan to God. Come on. This is radical.
Yes.
To open up their blinded eyes.
Yes.
Mind-blinding spirit. People, Father is just waiting for you and I to begin to step into the authority. So many things come to try to steal our authority, yes. To take our place and position, yes. That only Jesus can give us, that he wants you and I to live out, yes. And live it out in a big way. Things where we pray for people and somebody doesn't get healed, it can become a discouragement if you don't have your eyes set in the right place.
Amen.
Because it's God's will that you and I do what he said to do. Leave the results to him.
That's right.
Hallelujah. Because if you start getting all high on the successes, huh, or the failures, you get all disappointed on the failures, rather. You're going to get all high on the successes. You just need to leave it to him. It's his work. He told me to do this, and then I leave it right there. You need to start doing this, and watch what will happen. Watch what will happen, dear people. Watch what will happen. I'm believing for the academic centers of this nation, which is so represented here in Southern California, to be shaken. That's so represented here in California as a whole, from UCSD to Berkeley to Stanford to all of the great universities, UC Irvine, all the UCs, to see the fire of God begin to burn. Come on, we're already seeing what's going on. Veronica and then Chris and others, come on, watch what God will do. People, you know, I just had a young girl come and sit with me just the other night from UCSD. She said, I had no idea. She said, I got baptized in the Holy Ghost just a few weeks ago. A few weeks ago, we were in here and I went to, Allie had something on her body and I went to come down on the platform to pray for her. And of course, you know, when you begin to move in miracles, if you don't realize it, everybody can sense the anointing. Yes. She, as soon as I started to do that, she began to cry and shake. She ran to me, grabbed me, and she said, "I had a spirit of suicide on me. Can you break it off?" No problem. She said, "I've been living in this baptism of the Holy Ghost, which before I was afraid of, and now it's the greatest thing ever." Hanging out with Brittany and hanging out with this. Listen, God will shake the academic centers of this nation. I believe that this is a place of the stronghold that holds this sway over the minds of people in the United States of America with all the demonic doctrines that come out of the academic institutions. Come on, people. Come on now. Come on now. Don't you weary in well-doing. Don't you be shaken by the fact that you don't see all the things happen on your time scale, because God said He's going to bring to pass. Look how long-suffering and patient Father is. He says, "Dearly beloved, have patience unto the coming of the Lord, because the husbandman has long patience till he's first received the early, the precious fruit of the earth, which is going to come by the early and the latter rain." Come on, people. Yeah. It's time to just pick it up another level. Just take it to another, to take it to another place of submission and consecration to the Lord. Understand, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. God's giving you a new heart to think like Him. Yes. He's giving you a new heart not to have your own thoughts going on, but to have His thoughts. His thoughts are conveyed to us by His Word. Yes. Hallelujah. Listen, you can have instantaneously the event called the renewing of your mind. Just start thinking according to the Word of God. Hallelujah. Amen. Listen to me. It's the new covenant. This is a new covenant. I'm gonna read a list of scripture to you. I'm going to try to close here in just a minute. But I just like to preach the Word a long time. If I preach the Word of God till everybody wakes up. Amen. And then after you wake up, you can fall asleep. Amen. Hallelujah. I preach enough of the Word of God so you can have a supply to work off of all week. Amen.
Amen.
I try to do Bible school and seminary all and the church meeting all in one event. Look with me quickly, just a couple of verses of scripture, like in Hebrews. I just want to point these things out to you. I want you to get excited about what God has done. He's done a finished work. Yes. He's done a complete work. Yes. He's made a whole new man who is shaped in the image after righteousness and true holiness. He came down with the very Word, Christ Jesus, and shaped us anew. He brought us forth out of death into His life, to where we're walking around full of all that He is. Tabo romanjeste, full of all the divine power that has been given to us through His divine nature. He's given us everything that we need. Somebody said, "I don't have enough." God gave you everything you need. He gave you all that you have need of. He said, according to His divine power, He's given you everything that you have need of to have life and godliness, abundant life, a great outpouring of His divine power. I was crying out to God not too long ago. I said, "Oh God, like You've done before, like You did in the days of old, raise up people who will move in Your mighty power and signs and wonders and not get tripped up along the way." Yes. Yes. Lord, I don't care. Let somebody start moving in the ministry of Jesus, on the scale of Jesus, and even greater works. Just anyone, Lord. It doesn't have to be me. Just anyone. Oh, God, just do it. I'm just getting earnest about it. The Spirit of the Lord spoke to me and said, "I'm raising up a great and mighty army and not a few. They'll live this way, walk this way." You watch the events. God's got sovereign moves. Understand this. I believe in the continuous move of the Holy Ghost, but there are sovereign movings of God. Hosea 6:3 describes it. "Then we will know those who passionately pursue the Lord when He comes to us as the early and the latter rain." Those sovereign movements of God, you could mark it on a calendar in the Wells revivals, in the revivals of Scotland, like every 40 years. That's what stirred a young man named Evan Roberts to say, "What will it take for me to also step into one of these great moves of God that I've heard about, that happens about every 35 to 40 years?" And of course, what his pastor told him, it's all recorded in history. He did what his pastor said to do: be in the meeting every time the meeting's doors are open. Seek God with all of your heart. Let Him know that you can't live without what He's purposed for you to be in your life. And one day, it took place. Yeah. And a great renewal took place within the framework of the church that spread over into April 9th, 1906, right up here, right up the road, about 85 miles from here or so. Just outside of Pasadena, California, on Azusa Street. And it shook the world. in a little barn would be half the size of this building. Half, about the half back about to this, half of this little section here back. One-eyed black preacher standing on an apple crate. Huh? People rolling around on the floor, acting absolutely nuts, falling out under the grounds when they're coming up. Hallelujah. Never has spoken in the heavenly language, speaking and also interpreting right there with it. And Pentecostal fires burned. When I was young, it was just, when I was a little guy, it was plain, it was something, you know, you always saw tongues, interpretation of tongues, with a phrase then in English. And with power and glory demonstrating these things. People touched by the fire of God. You can't stop laughing and crying at the same time. That wonderful flow. And we see it waning. We see it waning. This is so waning. There's so many people, Pentecostal churches don't even anymore, because they said that was supposed to be done in the back room. And they so grieved the Holy Ghost that there's no room for the Holy Ghost anymore. There's no back room no more. Right. There's no room. Right. There's no room. They don't have prophecy because they grieved the Holy Ghost and didn't allow the expression of the language, because the language came first. Hallelujah. The language of heaven. They shamed of the Holy Ghost. People trample all over the anointing with their own plan and their own purpose, then wonder why God don't move. People, it's time for us to let God, the Holy Ghost, have sovereign rule. It's time for us to get radically and passionately expression about our love for Him, like the woman that came in and began to wash His feet with her tears and dry them with her hair and kiss his dirty feet right there as everybody's sitting looking. Oh, my goodness, look at this display, lavish. Look at this immoral display of affection. That was basically their attitude. And we know that Jesus said, Simon, I came in, you didn't give me any kisses. I'm going to ask you today, those of you who love God, did you walk in His house giving Him kisses? Huh? Is the affection of the Holy Spirit, is the Spirit of the Son so great on the inside of you? Come on, man. People, it's just time for us to listen. Somebody said, can't you just leave me alone? Can't you just be happy about where I'm at? No. Not when God calls you to have so much more and be so much better and have hallelujah, and live so much happier, hallelujah, and so much freer, hallelujah. Now and throughout the ages. Reality of it is everyone who has this hope purifies himself even as he's pure. That's why I scream out, Christ Jesus is coming. Purify yourself. Because we're going to stand before Him. And He's going to be, you know, He's going to be looking at us with those eyes. Those eyes that nobody needs to say nothing. Your whole list just begins to go right down. Item by item through your own thinking realm. I want to stand there with boldness, just raptured in love. Every time I'm praising Him, worship Him, I'm practicing being in front of His presence, being presented before Him with all boldness. Hallelujah. Woo! Hallelujah. Can I help you? You want to understand how to be made perfect? How many of you want perfect love? You want to know how to be made perfect in love? This is easy. It's easy. Know and believe the love that God has for you. God is love. Herein is our love made perfect. Hallelujah. Ha 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 ha. Hallelujah. Not believe in your love for Him, but believe in His love for you. Come on. Listen, people, if I could just get every one of you to understand this. Stop being down on yourself. Stop allowing condemnation and shame and guilt to overwhelm you. Start enjoying His presence. His voice will become so loud. Yeah. The movings of His Spirit will become so rich. Yeah. Hey, forget about all that Satan's going to say. He's the accuser. He's going to accuse you night and day. Yes. 24/7, 365 days a year. He ain't going to let up. But I found the channel He was on, and I turned Him off, man. I have turned Him off. I switched the channel, and I don't listen to His voice anymore. I allow the Word of God to dwell in me. I allow His Word, Baseremana, to keep my heart. Hallelujah. Amandeya sito, to rule my heart. Leyutura mandeya stokoya. Hebrews 8:16. I'm going to try. Give me rever. Todiashitanamoki. Rather rumbotean. Hasaleosipea. I'm going to obey God and quit giving commercials breaks about we're going to be finished in a few minutes. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 10. For this is the covenant. This is the new covenant. Say, this is the new covenant.
This is the new covenant.
Listen to this. Ooh, rabba, yeshayo, pateya. If you would just take every time you find faith in the Bible and put born again, new man, you'll begin to think differently. Everything will be changing in your life because that's what the whole faith is all about. This is the faith of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Say, looky here. For this is the new covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith God. I will put my words in their mind. In their noose. Hallelujah. That's a Greek word for it. I will put my word in their minds. And write them in their hearts. Talking about letting the word of God dwell in you richly by faith. Talking about I write unto you young men because the word of God abides in you and you've defeated Satan at every point. Talk about having the living epistle written of God and read of man, not with the engraving device of man, but written by the finger of God upon the tables of your heart. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 3 through 5, so that you can with unveiled face look into the mirror and see the glory of God, the glory of Christ Jesus, and there beholding his glory on you and through you, you change from glory unto glory. Come on, think about these things. Think about these things when you're feeling bad. You can feel bad, but you need to just get it that down to about 5 seconds. Who would ever want to go walk around feeling bad and discouraged and disappointed? Listen to the lies of Satan. When God would cause, he's commanded us to rejoice forevermore. Amen. Hallelujah. He's still commanded us to serve him with joy and with gladness of heart for all the abundance. Hallelujah. The abundance. Somebody said, why must you lift your voice? So that you can hear plainly. The abundance. There's no lack in abundance. Hallelujah. He's able to make all grace abound unto you. That's literally more than you can contain. He's able to do superly abundantly above all that you can think or ask, according to his indwelling you, the Holy Ghost who lives in you, Christ Jesus who dwells in you, the Father who's there, hallelujah, having set up his throne in your heart. Take my will and make it thine. It shall be no longer mine. Take my heart. It is thine own. It shall be your royal throne. Preacher's daughter wrote the song 1880 in their holiness revival, the apostolic holiness revival that in many respects ushered in the revival that we now call the Azusa Street Revival. The people crying out, oh God, we must have you. Oh God, the world's moved in too close to our lives and we're afraid we have the hour of great deception. Go back and read about it, people. We have to talk about, we glamorize the folks of the past. We need to get their consecration. We need to step into the sanctification that they preached and taught. I mean, who's teaching on sanctification? It's become a foul word in the community of the church. I'm there right now. I'm going to lift up my voice. I pray you lift up your voice and you don't back down. That you lift up your voice, first of all, when doubt and unbelief comes around, when condemnation and shame and guilt tries to smear you. Come on. When people, listen, people are going to speak evil of you. Satan's going to, I just tell you, this is the way it goes down. False accusers. They take something that you did and that you said or you did, and then they twist it. Just like they do with Jesus. This man said that he would destroy the temple in 3 days. That he would destroy the temple and in 3 days rebuild it. Well, that's kind of what he said. He said, you destroy this temple. Right. He didn't say he was going to do it. They took and changed one word and they used that to accuse him. It happens all the time. Satan's going to do those kinds of things to you all the time. He's going to do it directly to your mind or he's going to do it through people. He's going to try his best to stop you. He's going to try his best to invalidate you, to marginalize you. Don't be affected. Stand still. Let God take care of it. Amen. Watch what Papa will do. Amen. And nobody can stop you when God is on your side. That's right. Huh? Even when you try to help yourself, God's still going to help you. Listen to this. It's like when Abraham basically said, Sarah, just tell Abimelech you're my sister. Yeah. And then God comes to Abimelech and says, you are a dead man. Right. Comes to him in his dream. You dead. He's like, what? You have another man's wife. He is a prophet. He is a close friend of mine. And you did. But. And the good thing is he said, but I did it. I did it in the perfection of my heart, in the tamim laviv, in the perfection of my heart, in the tamim balaviv, in the perfection of my heart, and in the cleanness of my hands. Abimelech? Huh? Could do the, Abimelech, who was not even of the house. Well, there wasn't really a house. Right? Kind of was, because Abraham had already been called an Ivrit, or one who stood on the side with God. Against all, on the other side of the flood of humanity, it was just him and God standing there, and everybody else was over there. And here Abimelech, which he says, but with the perfection of my heart and the purity of my hands, or the cleanness of my hands, I've done this. And what did God say? Yes, you did it in the perfection of your heart. Thus, I restrained you from sinning. Who, Papa's more involved than what you imagine. Yes. When you're willing to walk with him, he's going to do some things for you that is unimaginable. Amen. When your heart's not right, it's going to beset you and it's going to stand against you because Father searches the hearts. Listen to me. He's written his word. Talk about let the word dwell in you richly. Thy word have I hid in my heart. Talk about getting his word in you. He says, if you want to be successful, if you want to prosper, then rehearse, recite. In the King James, it's translated meditate, but it's not that. At least it would be murmur, to murmur. But it literally means, the Hebrew word in Joshua 1, 6 and 8, says to recite. Recite the word day and night. Yeah. Yeah. That you may observe to do it.
Yeah.
To do everything that is written. Then shall you make your way prosperous. Then shall you have the success that God described. Come on, man. Can I just get you to do this? I guarantee you, it will change your disposition. It will change the outcome of adversity against your life. It will destroy every mountain before you. It will empower you to run through every troop, to leap up over every wall.
Amen.
I promise you to just believe these good things. I'm almost done, I think. I'll write them in your hearts. Look at this. I write them in your hearts. Paul explodes that. Read it for yourself in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. He explodes it in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. What he does, he makes it just like what God did on the mount. When God took the cut out tablets of stone, and Moses standing there looking at him, and he wrote with his own finger in the tablet his word, his ways. That is the same language that Paul uses concerning what took place in our life when he gave us a new heart and new spirit, which is the symbols of the covenant. It's the inward man. Hallelujah. To God. Now, circumcision or uncircumcision does not matter anything. God wants a new creation, and he wants a new creation that you know you have, and that you live, and that you speak, and that you move in. Is this a little bit different than maybe what you've been living? We want you to have this today. God wants you to have this today. He wants you to embrace it. He wants you to have this today. Look at chapter 10, verse 16. I can't help it. The church, because Sunday morning church service goes long. I can't help it. It's not my fault. Don't blame me. Verse 15, God says, the Holy Ghost is the witness to us that he said this. This is the new covenant. I don't want any other covenant. I want the new one. I want the one where Jesus is living in me. I want the one where the living word now lives in me so that the written word is established there forever. This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their hearts, and in their minds will I write them. And listen to this. And their sins and iniquities will I remember no more. Don't bring it up. Don't think about it. Listen, God doesn't know what you're talking about, even if you do. You start talking about things of your past, and watch out. What's going to happen is you might actually begin to experience them all over again. It opens a door for Satan to come and claim you. Listen, talk about the great things that God has done for you and experience those all over again. Talk about that first moment that you met Jesus, the first time the power of the Holy Ghost came upon you. Hallelujah. I mean, if somebody else wants to get up and dance a little bit, I feel like running dance. You're always welcome to get up and dance. In fact, what you guys need to learn how to do more is dance. You don't dance quite enough. You need to learn how to dance around in the Spirit. Huh? When you wake up in the morning, dance around and get excited about Him. Hallelujah. Woo! Thank God. Listen, I'm telling you, listen, it's not magical. It's reality. It'll change everything about you. It's time to stop dancing the world's dance. It's time to stop living after your own mind and thinking. It's time to get caught up into heaven. Recognize that you are citizens of heaven. Your conversation is in heaven. You're seated together with Him in heaven. God has put Him up far above all principalities and powers and might and dominion and caused you and I to sit right there. And the more we'll confess it, and the more we'll rejoice over it, and the more we'll dance over it, and the more we'll be excited about it, the greater the reality of the expressions of our lives. People are waiting for a day to come. It's the same way with healing as it is with salvation. It's the same way with finances and everything else. People waiting for a day to come. It's doubt and unbelief. God's already established it. He's done it. It's about time you start agreeing with Him and start seeing, looking on that which is not seen. We look after that which is not seen. We look on those things which are not seen. That's where our desires are. That's where our responses are. We don't have the desires on that which is seen. We look on that which is unseen. We respond to that which is unseen. Our desires are there. Our desires are not in that which is seen. We're not responding to that which is seen. That which is seen is temporal. That which is unseen is eternal. Father's purpose to remain in the place of the unseen so He can do a work of grace in our life that couldn't happen otherwise. He wants us to interact with Him beyond the sense realm, the physical sense realm. And He wants to enlarge the sense realm of the Spirit and of the eternal. It's time to engage people. Hallelujah. It's time to let God start enlarging your heart now that He's to give you a new heart. Hallelujah. Come on, man. I'm just preaching revival language to you. I'm preaching till you get it. Somebody said, don't you have another sermon? Got a lot of them. Got a lot of them. Hallelujah. I'm just going to preach the one over and over again till you get it. And it's the one that Christ Jesus is calling us in so many different ways. He's saying, well, just accept the wonderful thing that I did for you. Will you just accept this so great a salvation? Huh? Will you just accept how much I love you? I know you can't understand how much I love you. Would you just accept it? Would you cause me to let you feel it? Because I'll cause you to feel it. I'll cause you to know that which you cannot understand out of the realms of the knowledge. To know the love of Christ which passes knowledge. Hallelujah. Mm-mm-mm. Every time God talks about you growing, every time God talks about you increasing, He's always saying it in context of being established in His love. All the time He's talking about to grow up into Him in all things, even the head, Christ Jesus, which supplies everything that belongs to Him to the whole body, so that you also may be able to supply that which you've received. Ooh, so that the body might make increase of itself in love. Ha ha ha, ha de oh, kind of. And then all the world should know that we His disciples. And it keeps on going. It keeps getting bigger. And it's always centered around something so simple. I'm not giving you some secret mystery hidden between the words. We're just telling you plainly today. What? You got to have everything you ever wanted as soon as you just allow the Holy Spirit to start overwhelming you, pouring into you in a greater dimension, the love of Jesus. Hallelujah. Harobosikina sata. Hallelujah. Sayataya. Hallelujah. Tanakeya sutast. I wrote down, just so that I wouldn't forget, I wrote down a long list of where God describes Himself dwelling in our hearts, living in us. This is the faith, the mystery, the fellowship. Christ is in me. He's come to make His abode and His dwelling in me. He dwells in me by the Holy Spirit which He's given unto me. All this beautiful, wonderful realm that Father has given to us where He walks in us, where He lives out His life through us, and all we've got to do is agree. I pray in Jesus' name that everyone take a hold of that which God is supplying to us by Christ Jesus and call it yours. And call the fullness of it yours. And be bold in your speech. Be confident in your actions. Don't wait for some day to come. The day is here. It's already taken place. Don't let anyone take your confidence from you. Don't everyone belittle what God has done for in you, because he's given you the anointing. He's given you his anointing. The one who has anointed us together with Christ Jesus. Same anointing. I have the Christ Jesus anointing. There's not another one that's available. Elijah anointing's not available, praise God. The Christ Jesus anointing. I don't have the Moses anointing. We have the Christ Jesus anointing. And he teaches us everything that we need to be taught. What he's telling us. You know what he's teaching us? Dwell. Abide. Have all your identity in Christ Jesus. Function out of him. Think out of him. Live out of him. Let everything that you believe, everything that you dream, and everything that you think of yourself and view yourself to be, let it be in him. Let all your ability be in him. This is what the anointing teaches us, who teaches us all things, even as the anointing has taught us, that we should dwell in him. Yeah. We should have all of our identity in him. This is what my heart's telling me. What's your heart telling you? Out of my heart's not coming evil imaginations. It's an unredeemed heart. Out of my heart comes a wellspring. Out of my heart. Christ Jesus dwells in my heart. Hallelujah. His word dwells here in my heart. Stand with me. If you're uncertain today, and I tell you right now, here's what I want to do. I want to give you great confidence. I want to persuade you of these things. Huh? It's like, I beg you, I beseech you, be reconciled to God. Huh? I beg you, I plead with you, be right with God. Today, if you're not right with God. Somebody said to me one time, they said, oh yeah, we used to be like you. We used to live in holiness. And my thought was, what, did you backslide? Are you just trying to confess that you backslid? What, you say now that you got some, you've moved on into some kind of a grace that has taken you to another place other than holiness? Because it's all about holiness. That's who he is. Today, if you've not sold out your life to the one who purchased you, and really, it's to surrender all of your life to the one who purchased you. He bought you. If you say that he bought you, with the price of his blood. Now it's time to start living for him and be conformed to him in every way. So somebody said, well, tell me about that. It's going to affect every part of your being. Beginning with your affections and your heart. Beginning with your ability to be able to understand something so simple. How much he loves you. Today, Christ Jesus is here to deliver you from the pain and the torment and the suffering and the lust and the desire for the demonic realm. Somebody said, well, I didn't even know I had such a thing. Yeah, the demonic realm and the world are equivalent. All that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life, that's the demonic realm. He is the prince and the power of the air, the god of this world, that right now works in the children of disobedience. Today, God has said to you, every single person that's here in this place, those of you watching me right now on the web or on YouTube, he said to every single person, he's calling to every man, anybody who's willing to hear, come over into my life, come over here and stand with me. Come over here, I will give you everything that you need to be pleasing, acceptable, to have life and to have it more abundantly. I'll give you everything that you need to deal with the one who's come to kill, steal, and destroy. I want everybody in this place, I want you to lift your hands towards heaven. And if you can't lift your hands towards heaven, then let God change your heart right now. He stands here. God the Holy Ghost stands here right now. It is time for change. It is time for change. It's time that God's people change and be conformed. It's time that the world change. It's time that the sinner begin to hear God's call to them to be set free from their sin. It's time for the consciousness of iniquity to burn. It's offense in the hearts of man. Listen, God said this. He said that the heart of man and the imaginations of his heart was only wicked continually. And thus, he destroyed the earth with the flood. And he says, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days of the Son of Man. People's hearts are going to be that much more deceived and become that much more full of wicked imagination. Don't you be contaminated by it. You better flee from the wrath that is to come. You better hear the word of the Lord. You better understand that God has called you and I to be separated unto Him, to no longer allow things of darkness to creep in, but to find ourselves fully engaged with the life that He's given. Because, oh, it is the life. It is the glorious life. It's the abundant life. There's people here today, you've been living in the prison of disappointment. You've been living in the prison of failures in the past. The river can't really bust forth from you. God wants out of your passions. I want you to understand this. God chose a very specific word. He used a word that refers to your passions. Out of your koliah. We translate it belly. He didn't say out of heart. He could have said out of heart. But he wanted to emphasize something. Out of your passions and your emotions shall bust forth these rivers and expressions of God. Some people, your emotions. There are people here. There are people listening to my web. Your emotions have been imprisoned by this world, by disappointment, by human experience. God wants to release you. He wants you to begin to delight in Him so that your face can shine with a joy from above rather than look with the expressions of the perplexity of men. Oh, He wants you to be the expression of His word, the expression of His life. Oh, let the Spirit of the Lord begin to move upon you now. If you've never been baptized in the Holy Ghost, understand, Father wants to do that right now. That is the ministry of Jesus. Hear me. Hear me. This is the ministry of Jesus. There's so many people refusing the very ministry of Jesus. His ministry is to baptize in the Holy Ghost and fire. Do not let religion and tradition keep you back from all this wonderful, great salvation and communion with Him. Oh, Satina Manea. Oh, Satina Manea. Let God, the Holy Ghost, begin to call you out right now. Let God begin to call you out right now. Just begin to surrender your heart to Him right where you stand. Begin to just surrender your life. Just begin to agree with Him like never before and say, Father, I'm going to agree with You like never before. I'm going to live for You because I know You've given me the power and the ability to live for You. Oh, God. Father, You know how desperate we are for Your church to begin to shine with Your glory, with Your fire, with Your beauty. Father, here's Your people. We now, Father, that lest somebody obey, unless there be a people who obey and go all the way, men will be lost in the darkness. When men will be without witness of Your power and of Your resurrection. Let the church shine bright. I want you to begin to say that. Let the church shine bright. Let the church shine bright. The Lord wants to make it like a light city set upon a hill. But hear me. He can't do it without your participation. Because you can cry out all you for the rest of your life. Let the church shine bright. Let the glory of the church, which is supposed to be the fullness of Jesus, manifest it. Be revealed. But until you participate, until you yield, until you're willing to go where the Holy Ghost is beckoning you to come, pleading with you to come. He wants to go. He wants you to go all the way with Him in your behaviors, all the way with Him in your emotions, all the way with Him in your conduct, all the way with Him in your passions, all the way with Him in your attitudes, all the way with Him in your desires. Oh, if you just let Him come rule you like that. The attitudes that would govern you from here on in, the attitudes that you would have power to shut down before they ever gain ground. Who will be upon the Lord's side? You think about it. God looked at Josiah and said, there's never been anybody like this who followed after me with everything that was within him. What did he do? He became zealous for the Lord. He began to lift up his voice and cry out, who will be fully consecrated to God? Who will tear down the idols and the desires for things around them that are not what Father appointed for us? Let's go read about Josiah. He is an earmark of revival. He is he is the Old Testament revivalist. Probably more radical than Ezra. Probably more radical than Nehemiah. Probably more radical than Haggai and Zechariah. All revivalists, Old Testament revivalists. Josiah, what a great example. Come on, people. Papa's not looking for any kind of people other than one that are those that are filled with the zeal of the Lord. A zeal for his house. All these things that people want to say about the church today, I'm going to tell you right now, look at what Jesus' confession was when his mom and dad was looking for him. He said, I must be about my Father's will. We got to see exactly what it was. Didn't you know where to find me? I'll be in Papa's house. I'll be in Dad's house. I'll be there talking about the Word. Hallelujah. I'll be there standing in the place of praise and shout and rejoicing. Ha ha. Come on, man. God. Revivals of the past never resulted in less church. It resulted in more. Satan is able to deceive a generation, I think, on a scale like no other in the history of man since Christ Jesus. So people got all these various different names for the different generations, Gen X, Gen Millennial, Millennials, and whatever else. I just say pathetic generation. Come on. And then how does that give you a lot of identity? It's about time we wake up and recognize that God has purposed us to be champions of heaven, not of our own cause. Come on, people. Father wants to reveal himself fully in your life. Think about it. Just for one moment at this time, at this moment of altar call, this moment of where altar is all about you laying your being on the fire. It's about you bringing the offering, one that is holy and acceptable unto God, and put it on the altar and letting the fire of heaven fall upon it. I want you to think about these things. Consider the reality that God himself, the Father of lights, the creator of the heaven and the earth, wants to be fully revealed in your life. Just think about that. If you could be president of the United States, if you could be president of the world, it would not compare. You could have all that creation possesses. Still, it would not compare. And Father's made it so simple. He wants us to let his word become the authority over our life and agree with it. Begin to embrace what Jesus did for us at the cross. It's not any harder than that. Begin to embrace what the Holy Ghost now that has been poured out upon us freely would desire to teach us. Come on now. Don't get distracted. Don't get distracted. Father has us doing a lot of different things, but we're not distracted. We're not distracted. We're going after one thing. You know what I'm going after? I'm going to just tell you very specifically. I got two things on my agenda that I'm passionate about. And that is to see God's people in his house begin to fully live under the power and control of the Holy Ghost. Two, to see the more than 3 billion people that have never heard the name of Jesus one time mentioned. I'm telling you, God Father knows it. Right now, I would go to Kashmir. I would go to Tajikistan. I would go to Azerbaijan. I would go to North Korea. I would go to these places that have been imprisoned against the gospel. I'd go there now. The only reason I'm personally not there right now is because Father showed me there's a way that I could multiply myself. And more could be sent. 3 billion people. We travel our circuits of evangelism, and 3 billion people have never heard one time. Never heard one time. There's not a lot of people going there because it costs you everything. Come on now. I believe in evangelism in the church. I believe in continual ministry to the needs of the church. Don't get me wrong. But everybody, I just prioritize the fact that some people never heard one time. And a lot of our evangelism ought to be recruiting people to go and tell them. And there's no apologies from a passion. Because I know for certain that's where Christ Jesus lives big in you and me. Oh. Oh. I start talking about these things and it goes deep in me, man. I'm telling you right now, there's no reason that Jesus Christ should not be preached in Mecca on Ramadan. Amen. Because there's some people who believes that God's bigger than every other power. There's no reason why Jesus cannot be preached in Kashmir. There's no government. There's no radical Islam or radical Hinduism that should be able to stop one born of the Spirit and full of the Holy Ghost. Oh, come on, people. There's no reason that you and I should be stopped from being what God has purposed to be right here in Southern California. And you listen to me. You mark my words. Satan will try harder to stop the church right here than any place on the planet. He runs more interference with the anointing right here. Janice and Jambres trying to withstand the anointing and the glory of God being revealed. It's about time somebody smarten up. Somebody get a wisdom from above. Some people stop being pushed around on the playground of the kingdom of God and start rising to the Father's business. Start doing the work of the Son. Father gave it to us as a gift. It's not earned. God gave it to us as a gift. Today, right now. You're not like a child that differs nothing from a servant, though you be Lord of all. But he's given you sonship. Heirs of God. Oh, please hear me. Please, somebody, please. Let there be somebody, please. That will begin to burn with the same passion. Heirs of God. Co-inheritors with Jesus. Not just later. Right now. Those that are watching me in Japan right now, I'm coming. The church is coming. I was in Japan on the 47th floor of the largest hotel in Tokyo not too long ago. The greatest, most populous city in the world. A free society that is so barren of the gospel. The most unreached people group. Probably one of the most unreached people group in the top list of the unreached people groups. And I was crying out to God, Father, I said, Father, Satan looks so big here. You look so small. Why? What's up? I was crying out to God and that night and early in the morning, about 5 o'clock in the morning, and those of you from Asia know about Asia, know what's happening in Asia at 5 o'clock in the morning. 200 million Chinese Christians pray. That's some serious prayer. The Spirit of the Lord spoke to me and woke me up out of a dead sleep. Said, all power is given to me in heaven and earth. I'm just looking for someone to agree with me. I said, oh God, you talk about crying out, Lord, increase my faith. Father, help me to see where I've not been willing to agree. I'm telling you, I preached to you this morning the heart of the matter where we've not been willing to agree. We've not been willing to accept what he's imparted to us. We've not been willing to accept what he's made us to be. I tell you, in accepting him who he is, in accepting him for who he is, we fully agree to what he's made us to be. The world doesn't want it. They want you to have money. The world doesn't want it. They want you to have fame. The world doesn't want it. They want you to do the same thing, live on the same sad go-around that they live on. Live under the same yoke, under the same chain, with the same earthly vision. And that's coming at you right, left, and center, but it's time to break free. It's time to break free. It's time to let God, the Holy Ghost, right now. There is no sickness in your body. There is no sickness in your body. There is none. There is no sickness in your body. The rivers of God. The rivers of God. The rivers of God. Sukatayna maktika. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. The way is plain before you. The path of it fully revealed. You have no right to interpret or to see it other than what Father has described. But see Jesus now and lay down your life and let God begin to be the one that He's purposed you to be as He reveals Himself through you. Now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, a love flows, a grace flows, a kindness flows, a submission flows like never before. Do not be afraid. Don't limit what God can do. Now in the name of Jesus Christ. Now in the name of Jesus Christ. Right now in the name of Jesus Christ. I bless that wound. Right now in the name of Jesus Christ. Sotum de extai. Sotonki ingaste. Sangeirastai. Oh, Messiah. Come stand here. Come stand here. Lift your hands towards heaven. You begin to lift up your voice now and a shout right now.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. Yes. And a shout. A shout. A shout. My mama saying. My mama saying. And a shout. 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 Male. Mama mana. My dear brother, lift your hands towards heaven. Out of your belly flows rivers that are Holy Ghost. Out of your life flows these streams from on high. Sopa deo poco sante yamane. Mandaya satara monge. Baro sotea. Everything that belonged to this world that tried to claim you and impose itself upon you is broken off of you from this day forward. That you may begin to know the glorious realms of heaven. Soaking among the same. Beyond what you saw as a child and as a young man. Young men. God begin to make known His glory through you. Sotaria. Meresteia brusta. Mandara deste exia turista. Boramanda estedanane. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, every hurt, everything of the past, no longer able to hold you in its grip, I set you free in Jesus' name. I set you free in Jesus' name to begin to live the life of heaven, the life that God has planned. Moseresia tacastadera. Halebonda deste. Haribast estekist. What is your name? Sam, have you ever asked Jesus to come into your life?
Yeah.
You have?
Yeah.
You ever been baptized in the Holy Ghost?
Yeah.
Coming right up out of your belly. That's baptism in the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
See, you understand this? On the day of Pentecost, they were all gathered in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind. Clothed in tongues came and rest upon each one of them. And they all begin to speak with the heavenly language as the Holy Spirit gave them utterance. Did I almost say you understand this?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Well, let God touch you. Let God the Holy Ghost touch you right now.
Okay?
Where are you from?
Egypt.
You're from Egypt. What part of Egypt?
Middle.
Middle?
Yes, middle part. Yeah.
Where is that at? Is that out in east? Is that out towards Minya?
Yeah.
Okay. You know that? Yeah. That is back in the country. Mm-hmm. That is back where they lived like, they still dress like they did 2,000 years ago almost, eh?
Mm-hmm.
Wow. And you met Jesus way out there? Huh?
Not 2,000 ago.
Yeah? Where did you meet Jesus?
In my life, yeah.
Oh, you did?
Yeah. In Egypt.
In Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
Back out there in the country.
Hakadiyah
Shakonaya. I love Egypt. I love Egypt.
I love it too.
I love Egypt. I've been to Minya. Me though.
I'm from there. I'm born there.
Okay. You were born there. Yeah. I love that. I love Alexandria, Cairo, Mbaba. Huh?
Yeah.
That's crazy, Mbaba, huh?
Mm-hmm.
I've been in Mbaba.
Mm-hmm.
Walking up and down the streets in Mbaba. Can you imagine me in Mbaba? Kasiteya. Botani Ishipaya. Hatana Seya. Hana Sitikishti.
Let your glory so fill this life, Lord Jesus, that Egypt would never be the same, that the Middle East would never be the same. Let your fire burn so strong in him that your will and your purposes would be bigger than living in America. Ha! Zutayana Mashika! Zutayana Mashika! Nisto! In the mighty name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glorious Heavenly Father, fill this life completely. In Jesus' name.
Mando se este. Hallelujah. What's your name?
My name is David.
David, you from here?
I actually was here about 3 when I was little.
Okay.
You might not remember me, but
I think you probably grew up some.
Yeah.
Father, in Jesus' name, take this life and fill this life up with everything that belongs to you. Does that sound good? That everything about your life would be filled with the glory of God. That out of your eyes would shine his beauty, his presence. Out of your mouth would come the glory and the excellence of his words, the life-giving power of his words. Where you could walk around, tell people who are hurting and sick and diseased and in pain and torment to go free. Does that sound good to you? He wants all of you. He wants you to come know him and know his ways, and then he'll reveal himself through you. Father, take this tender heart and fill it up with you. Have you given your life over to Jesus?
Yes.
You said, has a change come in your life where you know that God lives and dwells in you? No. Well, let's have it today. God, the Holy Ghost, grab a hold of you and you live for him. Because there's only one other choice, living for the demonic realm, and that's hellacious. That's hectic. That's everything that is evil and ugly. And it ain't going to be on you. I take the blood of Jesus Christ and I paint you with it right now. I put it on your head. on your body, on your heart, every part of your being, from your head to your feet. In Jesus' name, everything about your life changes. This day, Spirit of the Lord comes upon you and changes you into a new creation, into a new man. Spirit of the Lord comes to fill you, to overwhelm you with divine power and glory. Just let your hands towards heaven right now. Close your eyes, let your hands towards heaven. Changed. I say a mighty man for God. I say a mighty man, a vessel of the Lord. Out of your belly flows these rivers of the Holy Ghost. And every claim of hell and of Satan upon your life broken. From this day forward, you begin to understand and know that a new creation has been born. A new thing that belongs to God has come into being. Side of you. In Jesus' name. I want some of you guys grab a hold of my friend here and be close friends with him and help him. Begin teaching things of Jesus. Stokayakanomokatai. Lurapana. Lupratana. Moshikina. Hallelujah. So who are you? Who are you? You called of the Lord, anointed of the Lord Jesus Christ. Who are you?
Golden.
What? Huh?
Golden.
Golden, where are you from?
I'm from Cleveland, Ohio.
Cleveland, Ohio.
Yeah. I go to school here.
You do? Where are you going to school?
I go to Miramar, but after that I'm going to San Diego State.
Oh, you are?
Yeah.
Well, the Spirit of the Lord is upon you because he's anointed you.
Yeah, thank you.
You know this? Astakidamombradeya. Where is your family from originally?
India.
You from India?
Yeah.
What part of India?
Northern
India?
Yeah.
Bangladesh?
No, just India.
Okay.
Indian, Amritsar.
Amritsar, okay.
Yeah. Like New Delhi?
Yeah, oh, okay. Well, you know that the great revivals of the last days are going to happen in India. India is going to be so set on fire of heaven.
All right.
You know that? No, that's what is happening. The majority of the human race will find its existence, really almost does now, between India and China. By 2020, more than half the population of the earth And you don't think Father's heart is focused on India? Ah, Toki Nama. From Sikkim to Kerala. Ah, the Pasiretama Satoki Niashaya. We have some Kerala people here, right? But I tell you, the power of God is going to, the glory of heaven is going to be unleashed and revealed. I'm telling you, these works and greater works are going to happen there. I'm telling you, the same works of Jesus, the same things that God purposed to do through his church in the first century is going to be seen fully in this last centuries in India. And you're going to have to be a part of that.
Right.
You're going to have to be a part of that.
For sure.
Osakara Meshek.
Thank you.
Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe?
Not yet. I never got it.
You never got it?
I never.
Can have it right now.
All right.
You can have him right now.
Okay, awesome.
So, hallelujah. Isetoronoshi. Isetoronoshi. Asitoronomongze. Receive right now. See, listen to me. This is the ministry of Jesus Christ. He's the one who baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. You know that John said that. John the Baptist. He said, I baptize you with water. But Jesus, the one who's coming after me, the Savior, the Messiah, he will baptize you in the Holy Ghost and fire. Now, Jesus, in his earthly ministry, never did that. But after that, he ascended up on high. That's when that ministry began. And I can see in your life that you want the ministry of Jesus. You want him to come and minister. See, you know, the church, many people in the church don't let Jesus minister to them. Is that hectic or what? Because they won't receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire, and that's his ministry. You understand me? But anybody who asks, and are you asking?
Yes.
Then you receive it.
Right,
hallelujah. Rabasa, right out of your belly. Right out of your belly right now. Out of your belly. Rabasa.
Thank you.
I know it's hard, everybody looking at you. It's just the way I do it, okay? Kasataramangaya, chatayalamangaya, esharavatayara. Hallelujah. We love you, man.
Thank you.
We love you so much.
Sede
nambo. Sede namosta. Sede mangaya kiti. Sataya botust. Speak. Spoke asi dust. Zele zuyazi, zubana. Let the Holy Spirit speak through you. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I love you, Lord, because you first loved me. Hallelujah. Come over here. Hallelujah. I love India. You ought to come over and watch these Hindis over here. Mana meya tai. Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Just begin to pray for your nation right now. Everybody in here, because there's a number of different people from different nations, different parts of different nations. Just begin to ask God in his mercy to cause the fires of the Holy Ghost, the fires of the Holy Ghost conviction to fall upon your nation. Most of you, your nation is America. Some of you, Colombia. Some, Brazil. Some, Mexico. America. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. The floodgates. Floodgates of heaven open. The floodgates of heaven open. The floodgates of heaven open upon this nation. The outpouring of the Holy Ghost upon these nations. The outpouring of the Holy Ghost upon these nations. The fire of God begin to burn like never before in the midst of our lives. Every yoke broken in Jesus. The fire of God upon the Philippines. The fire of God upon the Philippines. Irasusina. the glory, the glory, the glory, the glory. Come stand right here. Come stand right here. Listen, here's what, you know, listen to me. A lot of people want God to speak to them. And you want the Lord to speak to you. Yes? Many times when God's word comes, people are offended by it. That's unfortunate, isn't it? You're so hungry for God to speak to you, and then he speaks, and all of a sudden, it's not what you want to hear. Yeah?
But it's good. It changes.
Good. The Lord wants you to invalidate yourself. He wants you to remove yourself from the equation and make Jesus bigger than you. Listen, this is not only for you. This is where a lot of people live. If you're willing to do this, if you'll just begin to know Jesus and make Jesus all the all-important person in your life, all the stuff that you are, that you think, because you don't really even know who you are. No man does. All that you think that you know about yourself isn't even real. Let God tell you who you are, and he's going to reveal Jesus. He's going to describe Jesus. What a way to live, eh? You'd never be unhappy another day in your life. You'd never feel sad and rejected and like you somehow messed up and missed God and or left out. Won't be any. That won't be a part of your life anymore. You can make your whole life about Jesus from this day forward and cease making it about yourself. Hey? Jesus, right now. Panasikaya. Vendessa. S.E.I. Now, from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, let the goodness of God fill you. Let the goodness of God fill you. Izostan. Let the peace of God rule you. Let the joy of the Holy Ghost rule you. Let Jesus be the definition of your life. Right now. Issa, Tony. Issa, Tony. Yeah. Yeah. Issa, Tony. Issa, Tony. Ibronosita. Issa, Tony. Just yield to him right now. That's it. Just worship him. Now just live in that. Just live in that. God does not leave you an orphan or an outcast. Just live in it. Just live in that. Everybody, just lift your hands towards heaven. You know, you look like a plug when your hand's up there. Plug in. Jesus. Istos. Istotoni. Astaperisi. Isipaneste. Mandeste. Manist. Manist. Maniste. Here, what's your mom? Basta cage. Basta. Most. Menace. 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 You let the fire of God burn. You let God arise. You allow him. 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 Manny, there's no cancer in your body. There's none. Listen to me. There is none. I don't care what anybody says they observe. They don't see right. You're going to live a long and happy life if you'll live it in Jesus. You hear me? Listen, I know what I'm talking about. I'm the doctor here. I was in a place and somebody said, is there a doctor here? And I said, yeah, I'm a doctor. They said, there's a person who's been in a coma and we don't know what to do. Been in a coma a long time, don't know what to do, and it was very hot. It was like, it was in Nepal, and it was 110, 115 degrees, and they're concerned what they were going to do about hydrating her, being in that kind of heat. Just walked over, and I said, hey, sweetie, wake up. Immediately she woke up. See, that's just the authority that is in our lives. People want to try to make it different. You might, your mind might say that you can't be that or whatever your thoughts. Wrong. God said you are that. God said you are that. God said you are that. I said, God said you are that. I don't care what comes out against you. You may be in heaviness through many tribulations right now and trials of your faith, but God said you are that. Don't believe anything but what he said. Because God's going to bring forth faith through the process. I said, God's going to bring forth faith through the process. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 Hananangaya. Hanje kaya shan. Eha. Neshan. Maya shan. Anointed of the Lord. Anointed of the Holy Ghost. You have no place outside of this realm of glory. Hallelujah. Anointed of the Holy Ghost. Eja. Anointed by the Spirit of the Lord. Say Daramai. Anointed. Handa Shekaya. Monzest. Mondaya Prasona. Meyakisht. Monda Rasipa Hateo. Hallelujah. 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 Anointed to think different about yourself. In Jesus' name. Look at me. It's a simple question of your willingness. It's a simple question of your willingness to see everything as God described it in his word, or to see things as it's been described by the circumstances and events around you. A or B? A, you will see everything just like God described it in his word, or B, you're going to see it as circumstances and situations describe it to you, events. Describe it. So right now, I just want you to begin to rejoice because it looks good then. Woo. It looks good. It looks good. Yeah, that's it. It looks good. It looks good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Right now in the name of Jesus, I command this rotator cuff to be healed. Right there. There it is. Totally healed. Totally healed. In Jesus' name. There it is. Well, listen. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' name. And especially people that you don't know. And here's what we want you to do. In the context of doing that, also bring an offering to the Lord. Honor the Lord with your offerings. Honor the Lord with your substance. Honor the Lord with your tithes. Honor the Lord with all the first fruits of your increase. Watch what God will do. So shall your barns be filled. So shall your wine vats overflow with new wine. So shall the things concerning your bank account and your stocks be blessed.